Good morning. It's Friday, October 27th. It's about 9 a.m. in the morning, and I'm doing the video for this week. And the title of my lecture, Life in the Antebellum North. If you're not familiar with the word antebellum, it literally just means before the war. So this is what's going on in the North before the Civil War. The 40 years before the Civil War, it's the most rapid period of urbanization in American history. I know it doesn't sound like a lot, but the number of towns with 2,500 residents goes from just 56 to over 350 in the 30-year period before the war. New York is the largest then, New York is the largest now, and it ends up being the first city in America to get over 1 million people. People move in and out of cities constantly. It's typically every 5 to 10 years. 50% of the population moves. So you move into the city for a little while, you work, and then you move out to the countryside, and then that repeats with other people. The physical living in these cities, the housing is crowded. There are no high rises, so there's lots of people living in just little spaces. There's problems with water and sewer. There's no public systems. It's usually just left to private companies at first. And you're still getting water from wells and things like that. For police protection and fire protection, originally it's in private hands, like night watchmen and private patrols. And it's going to gradually move to a professional system, especially with police. I think bucket brigades and things like that for the fire protection. And there are lots of different types of entertainment. There's theater. There's different types of theater for different classes, but Shakespeare is going to be performed for everybody. Sports, some of the popular sports before the Civil War were the horse racing, boxing, running, and early baseball. You got urban clubs, you've got sporting clubs, social clubs, Freemasons, things like that. You've got street entertainment, that's especially found with lower class people. And then political rallies. They served kind of like a gathering point for everybody. And political rallies before the Civil War, they were more like a carnival than they were anything else. In the cities, for the first time, people begin living apart from their work. You no longer work and live in the same place. Now you're going off to work somewhere, really, for the first time. And the wealthy elite, they're going to gradually move further and further away from the city centers. And on a long enough timeline, you're going to get the creation of suburbs and things like that. And what's left in the middle of the cities is generally going to be the lower class population, immigrants, pollution, the poor and indigent, and things like that. We do have some public transportation. It starts with horse-drawn streetcars, but once we get electricity and things like that after the Civil War, public transportation will change. Wealth inequality is a really big thing then, and it's a big thing now too. The rich form this aristocracy of wealth and it brings them to power. And example, New York City. The top 5% of the population own more than four-fifths of all the wealth. So 80% of all the wealth is owned by the top 5%. We get improvements in manufacturing, we get improvements in machine tools. That means that for the first time, we're able to mass produce products. This mass production of products will lead to reduced labor costs, and prices start going lower and lower and lower. We get new things like the sewing machine is going to be invented. The telegraph is going to be invented. The telegram will be invented. And with the telegraph, the world just it becomes smaller because the telegraph was the internet of the day. For the first time, you could have near instant communication around the world. The countryside is going to change too. Agriculture will have some new inventions. For example, in 1834, Cyrus McCormick is going to invent the mechanical reaper. So no longer do you have to, use a sickle and cut down grains and wheat by hand. You got a machine that can do it and collect it. John Deere, he does not invent the tractor. But what he does do in 1837 is invent the steel-tipped plow. And that made it easier to cut through the soil. And it's really, more than anything else, John Deere's invention that opens up the Great Plains to mass settlement. And mass settlement is maybe not the most accurate term, because there's never a lot of people who live in the Midwest, but a lot more are able to move there once the steel tip plow is created in 1837. The growth of crops is also going to improve the lives of animals. You're going to get better animal feed, you're going to get bigger animals and stronger animals, and then that can in turn result in more work being done or more food being available. Railroads are going to spread throughout the Midwest and really tie the farms to market in large numbers for the first time. And where do these railroads go? Chicago and Milwaukee. Chicago and Milwaukee are both fairly large cities today. Chicago is the largest city in the Midwest. It is the third largest in the entire country. Milwaukee has over 1 million people. It is double the size of Atlanta. People just don't realize that. But Chicago and Milwaukee are going to become the most important port cities in the entire Midwest. And that's where all the railroads are going to connect to. Switching hands, or switching topics for just a moment, there's this idea that develops during the 1820s through the 1850s called true womanhood. And there were four cardinal virtues of true womanhood there, and it's all religious based. And very much this is a reaction to all of those mill workers, such as the Lowell mill girls that you read about previously. The four things that the woman is supposed to have: piety, she is supposed to be openly religious; purity, she is supposed to be pure on the wedding night, if you get what I'm saying; and submissiveness. This is considered the most feminine of these virtues, and it was said that a woman's place was at the home waiting for her husband to arrive. And then domesticity. It becomes the woman's duty to keep up the house and clean the kitchen and be there waiting for her husband to come home with a fresh cooked meal. And today we would consider that extremely sexist and inappropriate, but in the 1830s, 1820s, that is what was expected of a woman, and that's where this term true womanhood comes from. And like I said, it's all about religion, it's all about being educated, and it's all about morality. And there are speakers that are dedicated to this idea of true womanhood, books, magazines, you name it. And here's a list of some of the people. And let me move this little thing so you can see that picture. You've got Catherine Beecher, Sarah Josepha Hale, and Lydia Sigourney. So these are going to be three women who are actively speaking about the idea of true womanhood. And remember, that's that piety, purity, submissiveness, and domesticity. Catherine Beecher, she's an American educator. She speaks out about female education. She's actually one of the people who creates the idea of kindergarten here in the United States. And she founded something called the American Women's Education Association in 1852. She opened up schools, and she thought it was the job, the duty of public schools to teach moral education, physical education, and intellectual education. Sarah Josepha Hale, you know who she is and you don't realize it. Sarah Josepha Hale is the author of Mary Had a Little Lamb. And when you think of Mary Had a Little Lamb in terms of true womanhood, this piety, purity, submissiveness, and domesticity, it really changes the meaning of the song. Mary is a domestic who is pure and taking care of sheep. The white wool of the sheep represents that purity and that piety. And yeah, I probably just ruined your childhood. Sarah Josepha Hale, in addition to creating Mary Had a Little Lamb, she is the reason that Thanksgiving is a national holiday today. And she also, much like Beecher, is going to advocate education for women and children. And she's going to teach moral, physical, and intellectual education. Lydia Sigourney, she was a poet. She was one of the earliest female American poets. And she opened up a school for young women in Connecticut. And in her poetry, she writes about grace and religion, and she inspired other women to be poets, and she encouraged people to be true women. As far as the publications go, I've got three listed here. There's Goody's Ladies Book, The Ladies Repository, and The Young Ladies Book. The Goody's Lady Book, it was published by a guy named Louis Goody in Philadelphia for like 50 years. And each issue contained poetry, articles, engravings by prominent women and women artists of the day. And the magazine, while it was for both men and women, it mostly was about this idea of true womanhood. The Ladies Repository, it was a monthly magazine put out by the Methodist Episcopal Church, which today is the United Methodist Church. And for about 35 years, it devoted itself to literature and arts and Methodism, but it also contained articles and poetry and notes of interest for the women readers, and it encouraged their piety and purity and submissiveness. Then finally, The Young Ladies Book. It was a book that taught women how to act like a true woman. So it taught you how to curtsy, how to walk, how to stand in a corner, where to place your feet, how to serve the man of the house, and things like that. It was all about social elegance and how to survive in this true womanhood. All right, some other things that are going to happen in the realm of women. Birth control will become a thing. While it's not the same thing as today, before the Civil War, they knew how to prevent pregnancies. They knew how to stop pregnancies. They knew chemicals and formulas and techniques that could do this. So families do get smaller. Women are not going to contribute as much financially anymore because they're going to become basically domestic servants. And the world of men and women are really going to start separating. And women who have these common experiences, these common ways of life, are going to start congregating with each other. The South, however, doesn't see any of this because the South is still so agricultural based. This true womanhood idea mostly misses the South, except for in some urban settings. Religion. We got to talk real quick about the Second Great Awakening. Beginning in the late 1700s, going into the 1830s, there's this evangelical movement. People think that religion has gotten a little bit too scientific and a little bit too mechanical, and it's lost some of the feeling. And so people like Lyman Beecher, who was actually the father of Catherine Beecher, and then Charles Finney, are going to really kind of push the Second Great Awakening. The Second Great Awakening is based in the Rochester, New York area, which is upstate New York, and parts of Rochester were just full of religious speakers to the point that, you know, it was called the burned over district because so many people were being told they were going to go to hell. The outgrowth of this, the results of the Second Great Awakening, there's this series of nationwide revivals. So think of, you know, a big tent revival in a church you might find here in the South. That starts with the Second Great Awakening. And the whole goal of this was to breathe new life into religion, make it more personal again. And it's why we have the modern day Methodist Church and the modern day Baptist churches. There are a couple of utopian movements that happen. The Mormons are created by John Smith. Joseph Smith. And Joseph Smith, he claims to have found a newly discovered book of the Bible, the Book of Mormon. And his new faith is based on the Book of Mormon. He gains a lot of followers from this, but he also gains a lot of enemies, and he's forced out of New York. By the time he has moved to Western Illinois, he's going to be arrested after saying polygamy is legal and a new revelation from God. And he's going to be not just arrested, but he's going to be broken out of jail and then lynched for it too. Once Joseph Smith is murdered along with his brother, actually, in 1844, a new leader of the Mormon faith named Brigham Young is going to move the Mormons to Salt Lake City, Utah, and they're going to set up a colony there outside the bounds of the United States. The Shakers, they believe in perfection. They were originally situated in upstate New York, but they spread out a little bit. Never a truly large group, but it was an interesting group. There is, I believe, one Shaker community left in the country, possibly two. The Shakers, they believe in perfection. They surrender all of their worldly property. They believe just in communal property. And they devoted themselves to the bringing of heaven to earth. They believe that the physical kingdom of heaven would descend to earth and then they would enter it. They also believe in absolute chastity. Sex is a sin, pure and simple. The Shakers, the way that they kept their numbers up was actually through adopting young children or conversions. The Shakers, they pretty much die out before the Civil War, but like I said, there are one or two Shaker communities that still exist in the United States today in 2023. The Transcendentalists, this group is going to get their ideas from British Romanticism. It's a philosophical movement and also a artistic movement. And you got people in it such as Henry David Thoreau, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Margaret Fuller, Bronson Alcott, some very big names in 1800s American literature. And they believed in the beauty of nature. They believed that you could understand nature and beauty, and by doing that, you could express yourself fully. They believed that people are naturally good. And then they believed that society could corrupt the individuals. So they were very often people who either just kind of kept to themselves or, you know, lived by themselves. Henry David Thoreau very famously wrote On Walden Pond, where he talks about going and living on the side of a lake, where he gave up all of his responsibilities. Basically, he becomes a tax skipper, or, you know, quits paying taxes and things like that. These Transcendentalists, they found a place called Brooks Farm. And Brooks Farm is going to be a commune that's outside of Boston. And at Brooks Farm, these Transcendentalists, they come together. Everybody's supposed to work together and share the labor equally. And then they also get to share the good parts equally too. But there are some people who want to do less work than others. And then those who are stuck doing the regular work have to pick up the slack. And Brooks Farm, it just doesn't work. When it's destroyed in 1847 by a fire, the people living at Brooks Farm, they don't rebuild it and they go their separate ways. There are some reform movements too. This right here, this is Dorothea Dix. Dorothea Dix is going to tour prisons in the American Northeast in New England. And she's going to find that the people there are not treated very well. She's going to find that they've got inmates that are confined to cages, stuck in closets, kept in stalls and pens, almost like animals. These inmates are going to be chained. They're going to be naked. They're going to be beaten. And Dorothea Dix is going to be just appalled by what she finds. And she's going to advocate for having asylums and prisons run by trained attendants. And Dorothea Dix is going to encourage New England and then eventually the rest of the country to build proper facilities for those who have mental deficiencies or handicaps. She's going to encourage the building of ethical prisons and things like that. You also have these temperance movements, these anti-alcohol movements. And it was believed that alcohol was a major sin. At the time, there were people who would, you know, basically get their paycheck and just drink alcohol to the point that they wouldn't come into work on Mondays. to the point that employers, they called Monday Saint Monday because so many people called out. They were like, it's a religious holiday. Eventually, temperance movements will lead to the foundation of churches. If you're in Carroll County, halfway between Carrollton and Villarica, there is a church called Temperance Church. Temperance Church is a Methodist church that was founded in the 1850s that was an anti-alcohol establishment. The temperance movement is going to result in an ending to Sunday alcohol sales. Georgia still does this in many places. You either can't buy alcohol on Sundays in Georgia, or if you're in a location that does allow it, there's a limited amount of time you can do so. And then, eventually, when we get into the 1900s, there's going to be a constitutional amendment that actually prevents the creation and sell and distribution of alcohol completely. All right, last but not least, public education. In the year 1800, there's no public education outside New England, but by the Civil War, it's nationwide. And this is because of a guy named Horace Mann. Horace Mann is the head of the Massachusetts State Board of Education. Horace Mann is going to argue that a well-educated population is required for a democracy. Horace Mann, he establishes a six-month school year. He establishes formalized training for teachers. He emphasizes reading, writing, arithmetic. And businessmen in the Northeast are going to buy into this big deal, big time. Because if you think about it, school really teaches you work hard and you'll succeed, which is what businesses want to have their workers do, work hard, and then the businessman will succeed. Accept the instructions of your superiors, you listen to your teachers, you listen to your dean, you listen to your principal without question, you listen to your boss without question, and then do not envy the rich. Some people will make more money, some people will have nicer things, so don't envy them. So business and early education go hand in hand, believe it or not. And yeah, maybe once again I ruined your thoughts on school just like I ruined your childhood in this lecture. And then last but not least here, abolition. Almost as soon as slavery is brought to Europe and to the Americas, there are movements against it. The first large-scale anti-slavery movement in the United States is the American Colonization Society of 1817, and what they wanted to do was gradual compensated emancipation. So as people give their slaves up, they would receive compensation for the loss of their slaves. The American Colonization Society also pushed for the return of blacks to Africa, and the country of Liberia is kind of the example of what the American Colonization Society wanted to do, but in reality it was unobtainable because these former slaves are no longer African slaves, they are African American slaves. So they don't know the original religion, they don't know the original languages or culture or anything like that. They live in a new culture that is kind of a new way of life. Eventually, the American Colonization Society is going to be challenged by more radical voices, and it's going to fall apart. One of these radical voices is William Lloyd Garrison, and in 1831, he starts this newspaper in upstate New York called The Liberator, and it's all about the radical abolitionist views that many had, including William Lloyd Garrison. And William Lloyd Garrison and others like him, they called for immediate emancipation, immediate equal rights. And they argued also that America should stop supporting the government because the government was doing immoral and illegal things. Very often, white abolitionists and black abolitionists, they had the same end goal, but they wanted it to be done differently. For example, white abolitionists, they only wanted to abolish slavery. They did not want to give blacks equal rights, while African Americans wanted an end to slavery as well as full equality. Being an abolitionist was a dangerous thing. There were multiple people that were killed in the 1830s and 1840s over this. And abolitionists would constantly petition Congress to end slavery to the point that Congress actually quit answering these petitions. Okay, real quick edit here. For this week, we're on week 10. And between now and Tuesday, the 31st, I need you to do discussion 10 and quiz 10. And then looking ahead, on the 7th of November, your research essay rough draft is due. I've been somewhat lenient on due dates with the research papers up to this point, but I want to make sure you know that the 7th of November, that is a firm, hard due date, because I have 6 classes and I need to be able to read all 6 classes worth of rough drafts and give some feedback back to you on a reasonable time scale. So please make sure that you're working ahead on the research essay rough draft and that you have something turned in by the 7th of November at 11:59 p.m. All right, as always, thank you for watching. Any questions, send me an email. Talk to you soon.